Hi, I'm Mark Harmon, Executive Director of the Washington County Museum. William Jennings Bryan was a polarizing figure a century ago, and nowhere more so than right here in Washington County. On this episode of History Revealed, history authors Ken and Kris Bilderback will explore what role, if any, passions over a Bryan rally played in one of the worst fires in Washington County history.
So Ken, tell us why William Jennings Bryan was so controversial here in Washington County.
Well, he was controversial all over the country. He had been involved in many different issues. He was involved in the Scopes Monkey trial about the battle over evolution. And he ran for president a couple of times as a populist. Because, you know, this was back in the Gilded Age when people like the Rockefellers and the Carnegies and the Vanderbilts were fabulously wealthy. And he was the first national politician who really stood up and said that something had to be done about income inequality and that sort of thing. But to your point of Washington County, Prohibition was really the issue there that made him popular here.
Especially in Forest Grove.
Yes, because Forest Grove was founded as a dry town. From the very earliest days in the 1840s, alcohol was prohibited. And it became so well known for its prohibitionist stance that in 1880, the very first time that a sitting president ever visited the West Coast, that was Rutherford B. Hayes, who also happened to be a prohibitionist, when he scheduled this big trip to the West Coast, he, you know, scheduled stops in Los Angeles and San Francisco and Portland and Seattle, but he wanted to make a special little jaunt over to Forest Grove just to see the success of this dry town.
Well, but Prohibition also had its critics in Forest Grove.
Oh, yes, loud and vocal critics. And it was a political battle, to be sure, but there also was a string of arson fires involving alcohol. One of the pharmacists in town, for example, who was allowed to sell medicinal alcohol, his pharmacy mysteriously burned. Not mysteriously, because it was arson, but nobody, of course, was ever arrested.
Right.
And not long after that, the Congregational Church, the main church in town that was the enforcer of prohibition, also burned to the ground in arson fire. And it was very definitely an arson fire. It's a long story, but no doubt that it was an arson fire. Never could prove that it was directly related to prohibition, but everyone pretty much knew it was.
Right.
And to the degree that some of the churchgoers vowed revenge on the wets, if you will, the pro-alcohol forces. And
so did they get revenge?
Yes, they did. You know, in some ways it seems silly that Forest Grove was dry because you could just step across the city limits and there were saloons. And so, for example, on the eastern edge of Forest Grove, just on the other side of the city limits, there
were... Just within walking distance?
Stumbling distance,
yeah, all right. So
there were two saloons. And, you know, once again, very mysteriously, two saloons just happened to catch fire simultaneously one night. And they burned to the ground while the Forest Grove Fire Department came to the city limits and stood there and watched without crossing the line to put them out. But even then, all was not lost, really, because when the saloons caught fire, the townsfolk ran into the saloons. You couldn't really save a building back then when that was on fire, but they were able to save the barrels of whiskey.
Oh, so they got their valuables out.
Yes, all was not lost.
Good.
And so, you know, this went on for quite some time, and as long as it was just Forest Grove and a few other cities that were dry, everything, the tension stayed below the surface. But in 1914, Oregon became one of the first states in the Union to enact statewide prohibition. And even then, you know, people got by because most of the local authorities just sort of turned a blind eye to all this until federal prohibition, and a lot of people sort of blamed Oregon for getting the ball rolling there. And so by this time, by 1919, prohibition was really a national issue and a very hot issue, if you will. And so one of the things that William Jennings Bryan was known for, besides being a prohibitionist, was that he was just an incredible orator, and he attracted gigantic crowds. And he came in 1919. He was the lead act, if you will, the lead draw in the Chautauqua Festival.
Well, in fact, he was hired by the Anti-Saloon League that year. But first, you better tell us what a Chautauqua was.
Well, Chautauquas were festivals that moved from town to town. And they were incredibly popular in many parts of the country. They originated back in New York. But Oregon was one of the places where they really caught on. Because, you know, this is the time before radio or TV or even really motion pictures. And so most of what people in Oregon got, they just read about. So what Chautauquas did, they would bring in everything from religious speakers and singers and dancers and people from exotic countries who were visiting the country to talk about India or whatever, places that most people in somewhere like Forest Grove couldn't even imagine. And so 1919 was one of those times, and William Jennings Bryan being the big draw, of course, when he comes to Forest Grove in the middle of all the uproar over Prohibition, hired by the Anti-Saloon League, you can imagine that it was controversial.
And boy, did it ignite some passion, didn't it?
It certainly did. William Jennings Bryan spoke on Friday night. And, you know, he gave his usual rousing speech. And then on Sunday morning, right next to the church that had burned down just a few years earlier, another fire broke out. And it's a little bit ironic. It broke out in the business district of Forest Grove. And most times, a fire breaking out right in downtown Forest Grove, somebody would probably see it and you'd at least have a chance to fight it. But Forest Grove, besides being dry, also had very strict blue laws that didn't allow businesses to be open on Sunday. So downtown Forest Grove was deserted when this fire broke out.
No one on the sidewalk to see.
No one at first.
And to set the alarm.
No. And, you know, it's a long story, but people eventually did start to see the fire. And there are, I guess you could call them funny stories about the first woman who saw the fire sent her little boy on his bicycle to try to go find the volunteer firefighters. And he was pedaling around town. And just a long, complicated stories about, you know, the problems in fighting this. But really, it was a windy day, a hot, windy day. Nobody was going to stop this fire anyways. And it just burned for hours. And long enough, in fact, this is 1919. And so this is a time when a lot of firefighting was still done with hand-drawn or horse-drawn fire equipment. But there were a few cities, such as Portland, that actually had early motorized fire apparatus. And this fire burned for so long that Portland was able to get these, you know, remember, this is 1919. These are rickety old fire engines. They were able to get those fire engines up over the West Hills and all the way into Forest Grove in time to help fight the fire. And it, another funny aside, I suppose, is that the Portland fire chief headed to this fire in 1919, got broadsided by a drunk driver, never made it to the fire. He survived, but his car did not.
Oh, dear. Well, these photos really do show the amount of devastation that occurred with this fire. Just so tragic.
Yes, and we will never know for certain that it was arson because, you know, back then, first of all, look at this level of devastation. Nearly the entire town was burned. And so it destroyed any clues that really could have established the exact origin of the fire, not that techniques of investigation were that sophisticated then anyways. Mm-hmm. But people, of course, suspected arson.
So what were the clues that made people think it was arson?
Well, there were a number of things that made people suspect that, but they didn't have to wait too long to get an even stronger clue that this was arson. Because remember we talked about how William Jennings Bryan spoke on Friday night. This fire was on Sunday morning. On Monday morning, the next day, a former mayor of Forest Grove and one of the most prominent business leaders in town went to the post office to pick up his mail. And in it, he found a letter. And not just any letter, but the letter writer had said that he was upset about one of the speeches at the Chautauqua Festival and threatened to burn down the town.
But it wasn't William Jennings Bryan's speech, was it?
No, ironically, you know, he was the one that everybody was worried about the controversy and that sort of thing. But his was not the speech that set off this threat. This person was actually referring to a fellow by the name of Arthur Gibbons, who was he was a Canadian military officer in World War I, and the war had just ended. And Arthur Gibbons had been held captive by the Germans for quite some time. And he ended up writing a book about it, becoming quite prominent, talked about how he faked his mental illness, and Guest of the Kaiser was his book. And so he was well known, but certainly not at the level of William Jennings Bryan. And unfortunately, we don't have the text of his speech that night, so we don't know to what degree he spoke about Prohibition, but we do know that he condemned Germany, Kaiser Wilhelm and the German army and everything else. And he was, in his own way, controversial and famous in his own right. But it's funny that while we don't know if it had anything to do with Prohibition, we do know that the issues of Germany and Prohibition were tightly entwined, and in Forest Grove again especially, because this was also a time when a fellow by the name of Henry Weinhart was starting his brewery in Portland, and the few winemakers in Oregon tended to be German. And so there was a lot of tension over the ethnicity of Germans, not only from World War I, but also between the Prohibitionists, the wets, and the dries. So, you know, we don't know exactly what touched this off, but the letter definitely said that it made some reference to that black devil, the Canadian soldier, Arthur Gibbons, and it said, if you bring him back, we're going to burn down your town. And was signed The Other One and I, but we'll never know who those people are. We don't even know definitively that they followed through on their threat, but certainly all arrows point that way.
So the arson fire probably was not caused by Prohibition, though.
Probably not directly, but it was just one in another line of these incredible arson fires that plagued Forest Grove for many years, and this one quite possibly was the worst commercial fire in Washington County history. It really did just level the entire downtown, and actually was encroaching on Pacific University, but fortunately they were able to stop the flames from reaching the university.
William Jennings Bryan was a hero to many people in Forest Grove, Oregon, yet no one suspected that his visit would result in the destruction of downtown. Please join us again for the next episode of History Revealed.